Good afternoon, and welcome again to Kant Center Grand Rounds. We are really fortunate to have an invited speaker in an area that is certainly not only a priority for our cancer center, but for the National Cancer Institute. But I rather than introduce the speaker, I'm going to introduce the introducer. So I'm pleased to introduce the host for today's speaker, Dr. Melinda Irwin. As you know, Melinda is the Associate Dean for Research Affairs, Research at the School of Public Health, as well as our Associate Director for Population Science and our Research Program Leader for Cancer Prevention and Control. So Melinda will introduce the speaker.
Well, welcome, everyone. I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Lorna McNeill today to give Grand Rounds and to present her research entitled Community Engaged Research with Faith-Based Communities and How to Create Long-Standing Partnerships. Dr. McNeill is Professor and Chair of the Department of Health Disparities Research at MD Anderson Cancer Center, and she's also the Cullen Trust Healthcare Chair in Health Disparities Research. She directs the Center for Community Engaged Translational Research at the MD Anderson, which is focused on working with MD Anderson faculty to develop collaborations with underserved communities with a focus on conducting high quality, relevant cancer prevention research. And her research in particular focuses on the elimination of cancer-related health disparities in minority populations that take place in minority and underserved communities, such as public housing developments, Black churches, community-based clinics, and low-income neighborhoods. She's been continuously funded, receiving grants from NIH and foundations to better understand and design innovative solutions to address health inequities. Currently, she's the PI of several community-based studies, primarily working with African-American churches to identify reasons for cancer health disparities. So welcome, Dr. McNeill.
I'm going to do a quick photo. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Great. Let me get my timer on because I'm already over time before I've even started a function of too many slides. So thanks so much for this invitation, specifically from Melinda to come and give Grand Rounds today. It really is a pleasure to share a little bit about what I've been doing specifically at MD Anderson and the city of Houston around engaging minority and underserved populations in the cancer research that we are conducting there. And hopefully there's some information that I'm sharing today that may be helpful for engaging the larger community, not just in Haven, but in the state of Connecticut in the cancer research that you're conducting here as well. So we know that there are patterns of cancer incidence, mortality, and survivorship. They vary widely across the United States population. And very often when we talk about those patterns and how they differ, we generally term those as cancer disparities. We wanna see how is cancer distributed across a population, and where do we see cancer incidence, mortality, survivorship that is disproportionate in terms of the population that is bearing the brunt of that cancer burden. And so when you look at cancer incidence rates, this is showing cancer incidence rates from 2011 to 2015. In general, we know that men have the highest cancer incidence rates of between men and female. And then Black men in particular have the highest cancer incidence rates. And then we look at cancer death rates by race ethnicity, see a similar pattern. Men still have the highest cancer death rates, but African-American men also have higher cancer death rates as well. What I didn't mention here was white women have slightly higher cancer incidence rates, but Black women have higher cancer mortality rates. When we look at the state of Texas, which is where I live, our Texas population, this is projected for 2018, Texas is now, I know, the second largest state in the United States with about 28.7 million population. It is a majority minority state where 58% of the population are racial ethnic minorities compared to 42% being non-Hispanic whites. But in terms of newly diagnosed cancer cases in the state of Texas, and this is from the cancer registry from 2015, you'll see that more whites are getting cancer in the state of Texas than are racial ethnic minorities, such that cancer in general is a disease of elderly and the aging, and the white population in Texas are more in populous in the state, even though the distribution in terms of population is a little bit more diverse. So you'll see more cancer cases among whites in the state. But we do have some unique concerns in our state as it relates to who is getting cancer, dying from cancer, and these trends and unique concerns. So just in general, these are what our cancer distribution looks like in terms of new cancer cases and incidents. Breast cancer followed by lung, prostate, the major cancers that you probably see in most states. And similarly, you'll see a distribution here in terms of death, except this peak here for liver cancer. I understand that you also are experiencing higher level cancer. Cases. Texas is number one in terms of the incidence of new liver cancer cases, and that's largely driven by larger incidence in Hispanic population in our state, and that's occurring here along the Rio Grande Valley border with Mexico. We also have a significant increase in cervical cancer mortality that also exists along the southern border as well. This is looking at some trends in our cancer cases, and this is where we're improving, getting better. And these are some of the cancers in which we are, the rates are rising, and that as a cancer center, we wanna focus on. And you'll see that liver cancer is where we are seeing a significant increase, and in the next coming 5 years, want to be on the forefront of addressing that. This looks at where cancer is distributed within the state. And so these are, I pointed out, our larger major cities, Dallas, Austin, San Antonio, and Houston sits right here. But sort of in our more northeast section of the state is where you'll have most of the highest incidence. And this happens to be the rural areas of the state of Texas, where most of the cancer incidence is occurring. And then if you look at the cancer mortality rates, you'll see a similar pattern there. Some challenges that we uniquely have is that we are ranked fourth nationally in the number of newly diagnosed cancers, as well as number one nationally in the number of uninsured, as well as total number of people that are uninsured. So come from a state that did not do Medicaid expansion. And so therefore, a large majority of our population doesn't have insurance. And so as a cancer center, that represents a unique challenge about how we are going to address that and make sure that we're meeting the needs of the population that we're serving. 30% of our newly diagnosed cancers and 34% of deaths occur in racial ethnic minorities, and women comprise about 50% of cancer incidence and death as well. So cancer mortality or cancer distribution disparities also differs by where you live. We very often tend to focus on racial ethnic minorities and looking for disparities from that perspective, but you want to look at disparities comprehensively, not just focused on racial ethnic groups, but lots of other categories of populations, such as distribution disparities in sex, socioeconomic status, and also geographic location. And I like this particular slide because it looks at cancer death rates by race, ethnicity, as well as sex. And then I've added state here to show that it matters where you get cancer and where you might receive your cancer care. So if you look at white males and black women and white women, this is across the state, United States, Texas, Harris County, which is where Houston is located, and then this is the state of New York. Essentially, cancer mortality is equally distributed amongst those particular groups. But if you look at black men, you can see that it's not. Within the state of Texas has much higher rates, and then Houston, Harris County, higher rates for black males. But in the state of New York, black men have the same mortality profile that white men do across the United States and across geographic locations. So geography matters. It matters sort of policies and programs and promotions and outreach into various communities in order to be able to impact these types of cancer statistics. So when we look at what is causing those disparities and what's driving them, we tend to focus on these risk factors below. Genetic and biological factors are definitely at play, although not the major determinant of what we see in terms of cancer disparities. But there are some cancers where there likely is a more of a genetic and biological determinant, for example, such as triple negative breast cancer, why that might be occurring more among younger women or our African-American women, for example. Healthcare access is very important. I know there was a published paper here from the Cancer Center that was showing that Medicaid expansion across the country definitely helped to reduce or delay, improve the state of presentation of cancer, such that it may not affect cancer incidence, but definitely affected mortality because people had access to care that they previously didn't. Socioeconomic factors, poverty is a carcinogen, and that being poor puts you at greater risk for worse outcomes than if you are financially wealthy or have financial means. And then chemical and physical exposures, diet and physical activity are some of our normal cancer prevention determinants that we want to look at and address when we want to think about cancer disparities. And then when you look at that distribution of various types of cancer sites, you'll see various groups at our greater or higher risk than others, such that African-American women are nearly twice as likely as white women to be diagnosed with triple negative breast cancer, higher kidney cancer among American Indian and Native Naskins, and same pattern for liver cancer. And I mentioned for Hispanics in the state of Texas is what we see. You're probably very familiar with a larger death rate from prostate cancer and incidence among black men, cervical cancer in rural areas for women, and then multiple myeloma, for example. When we look at Texas cancer risk factors in the state of Texas, we are 42nd in terms of tobacco use, and that is a bad number. It's not a higher is not better in this case, with 3.3 million adult smokers, 14th in obesity, and 47th in HPV vaccination rate, which is really unfortunate because we were one of the earliest states that on a statewide level had adopted a law that mandated vaccination of all young girls. And then there was uproar in the community after the governor signed that law and it was reversed. And now we find ourselves 47th in the nation in terms of HPV vaccination rate. So these are some of our priority areas, some of the cancer risk factors that we are working on. When we think about how we address those, most of the research that we have historically done looking at disparities puts us in this green box, looking at these biological and genetic pathways, biological responses, individual risk factors, which I just mentioned, and looking at disparities from a demographic perspective. But moving forward, we want to try to focus more of our research, what I will call sort of in upstream factors, and that is having a stronger focus on the role of the social and community context and how where you live, work, and play really does influence your cancer incidence, cancer mortality, and quality of life in terms of surviving cancers. And that would be to look at things like neighborhoods in which populations are living in and how that varies in terms of people's chances of getting cancer and dying from cancer, the kinds of relationships that we're involved in, the kind of support that's provided, all the way up to, of course, public policies that dramatically impact sort of that cancer distribution, such as Medicaid expansion, for example. And all of this is particularly important because in order to another important mechanism to addressing those disparities, from my perspective, is, and NCI's as well, is to involve the populations that have these higher disparate rates in the innovative cancer research that's taking place at our NCI-designated comprehensive cancer centers. But there are barriers for the same populations that we're trying to reach to enrolling in the cancer trials that we are conducting. And so this is data from the NCI cooperative trial group that was published several years ago. And it's looking at trial enrollment for minorities versus white according to various cancer types. And what I've just highlighted is, for example, for breast cancer, Black and Hispanic women are less likely than white women to participate in clinical trials. A similar story is for colorectal cancer and lung cancer. The one cancer site that African Americans are overrepresented would be prostate cancer for African American men. That's a great thing and makes sense to see that type of active participation. But in general, Blacks and Hispanics, as well as older adults, are less likely to enroll in our cancer clinical trials. And there's some evidence that that enrollment is declining over time. So how do we reduce these disparities that I've just discussed and increase participation in clinical trials? So my major thesis for the rest of the day is going to be a focus on community engagement. That community engagement is powerful and can increase the participation in and the relevance of our cancer research to the populations and the communities that we're trying to solve. So what are those barriers to participating in clinical trials by the groups that we're trying to include in them? Well, you can look at it from various factors, and from a research perspective, we look at barriers that exist on the role of the participant or the patient, and then institutional barriers or study design barriers that prevent people from enrolling in those trials. And so many of you are probably very familiar with the Tuskegee syphilis study, for example, but these types of studies that were conducted historically in the United States that were unethical and resulted in great harm to some populations, particularly African Americans, still have a lot of mistrust and fear of the medical centers, medical complex, the notion that at the end of the day, we are still using people as guinea pigs, even though, you know, all of our ethical standards have been dramatically increased since that time. But some of those, that fear and perception still exists, and we need to address that. There's often information overload when it comes time to invite people to participate in clinical trials. So I do work with breast cancer survivors, and, you know, the day that you get diagnosed with stage 3, you know, breast cancer is the day that we want to enroll you in the next innovative cancer trial that's going to impact your trajectory, but it may not be the right time for that person to be able to receive the information about whether or not this is the right decision for them to make. Not all clinical trials are free. Some of them have co-pays and costs, and often if you don't have insurance, you may not be able to participate in a trial. And then there's things like lack of transportation and financial constraints, communication barriers, all of these kinds of things that exist on the individual that reduce their ability to participate in a clinical trial. But what's known in the literature and work that we've done in Houston shows that partly it's lack of awareness about what clinical trials are available because patients aren't uniformly and consistently being invited to ask to participate in those clinical trials. Well, why aren't they being asked? Well, there's lots of institutional barriers to that consistent practice of inviting everyone to participate in a trial. Provider time constraints, multiple and competing clinical trials in terms of prioritization of those studies, whether or not this particular patient may be good for one study over another study, in terms of physician preference for a specific therapy exists, communication barriers on both sides from an institutional perspective, restrictive eligibility criteria. Very often there are clinical trials that, you know, will exclude people if they have hypertension or exclude you if you, you know, have diabetes. So, you know, I like to say that if you have a trial that excludes diabetics and hypertensives, then you don't want any African Americans in your trial. That's not what you're thinking when you're designing that study, but that is an unintended consequence of these types of eligibility criteria. And so more thoughtful conversation needs to take place about what is necessarily really required for that clinical trial and what might be excluding people and unintentionally. Study complexities, you know, trials, people have to come back every single day or come back weekly, go through multiple tests. There might be some populations that may be able to adhere to that type of study complexity and other populations that make it more challenging. And again, systematically not asking patients as well. And so these types of factors can exclude up to 50% of minority patients, meaning before they might even be enrolled in a study, before you can invite them to enroll in the study, have already excluded them from being eligible to participate. So there's a big difference when we think about research from research that's being done on populations and communities, ones that are being done in populations and communities, and those that are being done with populations and communities. And of course, my main premise is that we should be doing research with populations and communities, because we're all part of a community. If you think of at some point in your life, you're a patient, probably a patient right now, got some kind of condition. Families are communities, nonprofit organizations, our cultural groups, our faith-based organizations. The public is a community, but very often when we think about engaging the community within our studies, we generally think of racial ethnic minorities. And when you think of it from that perspective, that group is other. That group is other than me. My point is that we are all part of a community today. And if you were being, you know, someone was doing a clinical trial and is in the community that you are a part of, you might want to be included or involved in that trial. You might want someone to come to you and ask you, is this the right way to approach the community that you are a part of? And so I think it's important to recognize that we're all a part of communities. Yes, we focus on racial ethnic minorities because they're have disproportionate participation, but keep that in mind that we're all part of a community and might want to be engaged in a similarly ethical and engaged way in order to better learn how to engage in the research that is being conducted. So there's a continuum of partnerships and collaboration. You can go all the way on this side to just some form of community involvement, you know, from outreach and how you might provide the community with some information. And then it gets more involved over time from consulting the community, involving, collaborate, all the way through more of a shared leadership model, what we might consider community-based participatory research. Not every single research study needs to be on this level, but I argue that each one does need to have some kind of outreach in some form of engagement with the communities and the populations that we're seeking to enroll in our clinical trials. So I'm going to spend the next portion to give you a brief case study of work that I've been doing around engaging African Americans in this research that we're doing at MD Anderson, using that as a model for learning how to collaborate with and engage various different population groups. And so African-American churches have promoted health, education, business, political activism within the African-American community historically, because they were excluded from other mainstream ways to kind of get this these services and this information. And so the Black church became the place that everything was provided. So while they do care about the spiritual health of the population in the community, they also care about the physical health of the population and community. They've been effective partners for health promotion efforts, including cancer, diet, and physical activity. So I'm trained in public health and got my master's of public health at UNC Chapel Hill. And that was one of the first, ground zero of really doing a lot of research with African-American churches and engaging them as research partners in cancer prevention efforts. And so I learned a lot in that setting. 70% of African Americans regularly attend church. This is data from the Pew Internet Research centers. And in general, families are part of churches for generations. So depending on the kinds of studies that you want to do, where you need to follow people over time, this may be an opportunity for you to find people that seem to be hard to reach or lost to follow up to be able to locate participants in later years. So when I first came to MD Anderson about 14 years ago as a bright-eyed, bushy-tailed assistant professor, wanting to do community-engaged, research, we wanted to implement a research study that was going to look at cancer health disparities and address it more from that holistic perspective to look at individual factors, but try to look at more upstream factors. And I suggested that we partner with African-American churches. I had been trained in terms of working with African-Americans through churches my whole career. Plus, I'm originally from New York. We are West Indian Jamaican. And my mother grew up going to church my whole entire life. I say that I've gone to church way more than probably most people have, and that I have, me and God have a really special relationship as a result of that. But it's also a very familiar setting to me. I know a little bit about the people and the culture from a church-based perspective, and thought that they would be good partners for engaging in this research. So we started a partnership and a collaboration that we call Project Church. It stands for Creating a Higher Understanding of Cancer Research and Community Health. It was part of a research study where we wanted to investigate the role of biological, behavioral, social, environmental factors on minority health and cancer disparities among African Americans in the Houston area. The long-term goal is to use the data and the knowledge that we derived in order to improve quality of life and improve the cancer risk profile for African Americans, to engage them in cancer research, but to create a long-term, mutually beneficial partnership focused on doing cancer research for years to come. So when you look at wanting to partner with people, we all do collaborative or team-based science. Everyone has strengths that they bring to the table. And so from the church's perspective, this particular church that we initially partnered with had a very large, diverse congregation. So there's about 2.5 million people that live in the city of Houston. And Houston is home of the mega church. So if any of you have, you know, heard of Joel Osteen, or, you know, kind of like where his church is, a former basketball stadium, you know, we routinely have churches that have 5,000 people in them. And so they have access to the populations and the communities that we're interested in engaging in our research. They're committed to reducing cancer in African Americans, longstanding community relationships. And from an MD Anderson perspective, you know, we bring knowledge of cancer, cancer disparities, and knowledge about how to conduct conduct research in a culturally competent way. So Project Church had five aims, and I'm going to only touch on these really briefly, but please feel free to ask me questions about how we did anything in depth when it's done. But the first aim was to develop the research collaboration. The second aim, we focused on doing a cohort study together where we're going to try to recruit about 1,500 African Americans and follow them for 3 years. We're going to aim three, share the findings back with the church committee. Aim four was to provide referrals for health-related services and do some cancer prevention programming within the church setting. And then to five was to develop and evaluate interventions that were going to improve the health profile. So from the data that we received, where do we need to target and focus on in terms of to reduce cancer risk? So in terms of aim one, developing the collaboration, for any of you who do work within African Americans and focus on church-based settings, you may know that that relationship really begins with the pastor. They are an important gatekeeper of that particular church community. And usually when they endorse something, the church body and the members generally come alongside of him to support those types of decisions. So for me, it was meeting this particular pastor of this church. And we had at least four meetings over 2 years when I first got there. And questions that he would ask me in these meetings were, for example, how does his church benefit from their participation in this particular partnership? You know, why was his church selected as opposed to others? Will his congregation get care at MD Anderson? That was a really important issue. I just showed you the uninsured rates in the state of Texas, and not very different in the city of Houston. Is, will this collaboration confer additional benefits to his population? And in essence, what he was trying to find out is, you know, can I trust you, right? So I look like him in terms of being African-American, but I'm not like him. I'm a woman, that's number one, but I'm also from New York, and I don't know anything about Texas and culture, and I definitely don't know anything about his church and the culture that exists there. So I have to learn that, and he needs to vet me to make sure that this is going to be something that is going to be appropriate for his church. And so I attended church services whenever possible and provided information was requested, and the whole point of that was to reduce the barrier of trust within this particular community. Sorry, it's a double slide. Focus on here. We developed a community advisory board, and their job is to share the identity and the history and the symbols and the language and the culture of that particular target population. In this case, it was the church population. So it was populated with ministry leaders. There was also cancer survivors. There were parents and the elderly that the pastor had appointed to serve on this particular advisory board. They helped identify challenges and barriers to implementing the study. But assisted and advised on all aspects of the study that we were doing in the partnership, such as the informed consent process, recruitment intention. And one thing that they were really concerned about was the ethical conduct and confidentiality of when people were providing their data, you know, where was it going to go? Where was it going to be stored? Who was going to have access to it? Things of that nature that I would not have known that maybe rose to a level of making a decision whether or not you were or were not going to participate. It might have rested on whether or not the data were going to be kept confidential. These are some of the things that they were sharing with us to let me know what was really important. In terms of how we recruited the 1,500 participants, what's very common is on a Sunday morning, you know, the pastor maybe talks about this particular partnership in front of the church congregation. What he also did was allowed me to address the congregation as well, to talk about this partnership and this study that we were doing. And they wanted to do a health fair, which I hate health fairs. I mean, we all know that they're not evidence-based. We do them anyway. And I wanted to resist that, but the advisory board was telling me, no, we know our people, we know what's going to work. 500 people signed up to participate in the study on one day when we rolled it out doing, you know, in the way that which we've done it. And I'll show you a little bit more about how that was done. Video announcement during churches, people hand out recruitment cards. But one of the major things that we were able to do was get space within the church so that we can enroll people in our cohort study. So instead of asking people to come to the medical center, which no one wants to come to any medical center, because it's, you know, tedious and you have to park and it costs a whole bunch of money, you get lost. Instead, we came to where the people were and set up an office within the church. So this is an example of our project church office. When people walked in, what the setup was and some health education information that was there, for example. So in terms of aim two, developing the focusing on the research, we focused on doing a prospective longitudinal cohort study. One, we wanted to investigate these particular factors, but it was also the design that was going to reach as many people as possible. And so our goal was to recruit 1,500 church members. I can tell you a little bit more about how benefits that the church and the participants received for participating in addition to compensation. In those first 3 years, we were gonna do annual data collection. Year one was a baseline survey, and then subsequent years added on optional procedures. So year two, we collected DNA for biobanking, and about 1,291 of the original 1,500 agreed to participate in that. And so that was 92% participated of that, but that's of the people who came back. And then in the year three, wanted to collect objective measures of physical activity. Belinda would love to see that. 500 actigraphs were strapped to folks to collect objective physical activity data, for example. So we asked about 280 questions overall. These are some of the categories that you'll see. We tried to keep it as comprehensive as possible with focusing on burden as well. So the older you were, the longer it took because you had to answer a whole bunch of questions about screening. The younger you were, you know, it was quicker for you to complete the survey. And then with the, you know, advisory board, we talked about adding additional questions in subsequent years of things that they were interested in and wanted to learn more about within the congregation, for example. So in subsequent years, we added two additional churches. The first one we started with is Church A, and then Church B and Church C, as I've labeled them. These were smaller churches, but overall, our final sample size over all of the data collection for what we call Project Church was about 2,338. This just shares some demographic data on what the population looked like. It was about 74% female. This is very common in terms of the distribution that exists in churches. It's very dominated by women. Mean age was about 46 years old. This was not a very low income, low SES group, so I'll make that be known. About 45% were college graduates, but 61% reported one or more medical conditions. About 5% were cancer survivors, and 54% were obese. If I included the statistics on overweight, it was 70% were overweight and obese. Very common as well amongst African Americans. And then this just shows you the distribution of some of the cancer risk factors within the population. serving the fruits and vegetables, smoking status, depressive symptoms, having getting prostate cancer screening, colorectal cancer, and not current on their mammogram. And what you'll likely see is that Church B stands out. That was purposely recruited to be lower income, you know, lower SES. And when you can see that when you do that, you'll start to see poor cancer prevention behaviors being performed in that particular group. But what you'll see is even in sort of, you know, moderately educated sample, you'll see a great number of women that weren't current on their mammogram. You might expect to find lower, but we didn't. High numbers of age-appropriate people that have never been screened for colorectal cancer, and even higher rates of smoking status. You generally find at least self-reported smoking and alcohol use to be lower among faith-based populations because they don't actually do it or they don't want to disclose that they do it either way. But you still see sort of higher rates here. As a reminder, as a reminder to me, I'm telling you for the first time, this was not a representative sample. And so, you know, if you want to know how this sample relates to the larger, you know, Houston area, if we had done more of a random sample, that it does look slightly different, but some of the factors do look similar. And I can point out some of those as well. In terms of sharing findings back with the community, this is an important tenet of doing collaborative research. We cannot be seen as the researchers that are coming to collect data from people and never sharing back what they find. That is a strong pet peeve of communities, but as scientists, we're never trained to share findings back with anybody. It's published in a journal, and maybe it changes practice, but the people that we enroll in our studies that builds the findings that we have is not a common practice. And so we need to change that paradigm and share what we were learning with the community. So these are reports that we developed that in aggregate would share some of the data that I just showed earlier back with the community, the research participants, and then with the larger community so they could get an understanding of what we were finding and then what we were doing. We also developed an ancillary studies committee who would evaluate. We want others to be able to use this data that we're collected to learn more about African-American community and then identify potential interventions to help support that. So the committee assesses whether or not the research is of value to African-Americans, and these data have been used to contribute to several GWAS studies nationally. We have several papers published around the various cancer prevention behaviors and health literacy, for example. In AIM 4, we provided referrals to focused on cancer prevention programs. So to the extent that we were identifying people who needed cancer screening, we have obligation to figure out how to get them screened. To the extent that we were identifying church members who did not have a usual source of care, we're obligated to figure out how to connect them to the source of care. And Anderson didn't have to provide the care, but we do need to navigate them to a source of care. And so that's one of the major things that we spent our time doing, and over 100 referrals were provided. And in terms of cancer prevention activities, this, for example, is like to increase physical activity, maintain body weight, was a salsa class that we paid for an instructor to deliver. And this was with like the singles ministry, for example. And so they wanted to engage in more physical activity, smoking cessation. We developed a newsletter that was specifically focused on major cancer risk factors. And then in about the third year, the advisory board was hearing back from the church community and says, okay, this is good, but you still can do better. And what they wanted to know was, well, what does my individual cancer profile look like? Am I at risk for, you know, developing cancer? And as we know that those are very individual factors, we look at things on a population level. But what we could do is perhaps provide them data about their own question, their own answers to survey questions. So how are they doing in terms of fruit and vegetable consumptions? Were they obtaining at least 5 servings a day, for example, or how many minutes of physical activity were they getting? What was their BMI? So we developed an individual feedback that we called a health assessment that broke down those specific areas, our computers were able to calculate, you know, sort of their scoring and then provide that data back to them, and that met that particular need. So what did we achieve? So we definitely developed the collaboration. The name of the church that I had mentioned before was with the Windsor Village United Methodist Church. We met the research goals. We partnered with two additional churches later, and we were able to recruit 1,500 and follow them for 3 years. The first cohort of 1,500 took about 6 months to enroll, and we did a fourth data collection point, so retained about 80% of folks over the course of 4 years. So not super labor intensive. They had to come back every year and annually and complete a survey, but nevertheless. And actually, it took 6 months to recruit 1,500. We probably could have done it in 4 months. We weren't prepared, actually, for the positive response from the community members who wanted to participate in this research and in this partnership. And so we were actually understaffed. But nonetheless, this is either the learning lessons about sort of engaging communities in the right way and the response that you can get. So, you know, the motto is, if you engage them, you know, they will participate, similar to if you build it, will they come? And in this case, you know, my experience over many years now working with African Americans in this way is the answer is yes. So why do they participate? So we asked on one of the follow-up surveys in a closed-ended way and an open-ended, you know, why did people choose to participate? And they noted the strong church involvement, the endorsement by their pastor, the formation of the advisory board who was able to communicate positive messages about the benefits of participating in this. Many had a personal or family history of cancer. I don't know if I shared that statistic, but over, you know, 50% had noted a family history of cancer. There was lots of altruism, service to God and mankind, that this may not benefit me personally, but maybe it's going to benefit my children and my grandchildren. There's something that I can do to see that they don't get cancer in the future. Our also goal and job was to introduce participating in clinical research in a very positive way where we were providing the utmost customer service. And so they noted that as well, that all the research staff was very knowledgeable and, you know, it was very clear, you do not have to participate and you will lose no benefits to you at MD Anderson if any time you choose not to participate, things of that nature. And then these are some of the quotes, from an open-ended perspective that people mentioned, but basically we tried to reduce the barriers and increase the trust of that community in order to have participation in this particular research. Then in terms of AIM 5, how did we leverage it? So what did we do when we got that data? And how is it now, you know, benefiting? We started this in about 2008 in terms of the first participant being enrolled. You know, so where are we, you know, now 10 years later? This is just a sample of some of the grants that have been received. I am some of the PI of some of them and other faculty, other PIs of them as well, but leverage that partnership and that infrastructure in order to continue this particular research. And so we, when we do research within the Project Church framework and there's a grant, the church is always a subcontract on that grant. If there's any financial benefits that come, they receive financial benefits to participate. We've done studies with them where we built their capacity to conduct research, and so have hired and trained research coordinators that sit at the church who also can help facilitation of enrollment into research as well. So we worked together to identify, bring resources on board. I mentioned the church is a co-lead. I have a grant leased to the Cancer Center for a non-health educator. I believe you have one here as in Yale as well. That person is situated within our church network, and they provide this ongoing health education to the church community, even though the research portion has now concluded. And these are some of the populations, just a snapshot, that have been enrolled in various studies over that time. My most ambitious one is a family obesity study that I'm the PI of, where I'm going to recruit 900 African-American families into a study. So please pray for me. Anybody that has done intervention work, you know that recruitment is, you know, the hardest thing ever, but I'm fully confident that I can do it. It's a 3-hour randomized controlled trial. We're going to recruit 24 churches. And it's recruiting one parent and one child. And we've developed this study and this grant that we received from American Cancer Society to focus on Houston area churches. And then I recently received the R21 from NINR that's going to use a similar infrastructure and engagement plan to focus on Hispanic churches in Houston as well. Another faculty member that has utilized this infrastructure is Karen Bazaninqua. She also does physical activity research focused on breast cancer, cancer survivors. She had done an evidence program that was to improve quality of life among breast cancer survivors. And then she got funding from CPRID to place this program in community-based settings now. And she wanted to focus on African Americans. So she utilizes the Project Church network of churches for collaboration. My team provides her team with training and ongoing technical assistance about how to work with African American churches. Thus far, the churches and the members that have participated in this particular program, she's seen 60-71% follow rates, which from her perspective is very good compared to other communities where she's been trying to implement this in. And then, of course, those that participate have the same kind of program outcomes as anybody else. And then lastly, I'll mention utilizing this community engaged framework about engaging other communities as well, other disparate communities. And so we recently got a supplement to our Cancer Center Support Grant to focus on rural populations in the state of Texas and rural Northeast, where I told you all the incidents and the mortality is. That's where we're going to start to go and focus on tobacco. They have the highest rates of lung cancer incidence and mortality in the state of Texas, and want to definitely be influential helping and bring that down. But we're going to use this the same type of framework in order to build collaborations and partnerships in that particular area. Other additional community engagement strategies I want to briefly touch on. I direct the Center for Community Engaged Translational Research that Melinda talked about. And basically what we do is facilitate collaborations between MDN researchers and the community. And so we have over 50 local partners that they serve 1 million people. But those are the partners that we go to whenever faculty and researchers, either within our CTSA or within MD Anderson, want to do more research in the community. We'll tap into those networks. Why does it keep moving forward? Anyway. CEDAR has supported over 46 research studies that have brought in over $77 million. And we discuss clinical trial participation within the community on a widespread basis. We also have a community scientist program, and I believe you have a program similar here that is your community ambassador program, where we have trained community members to give rapid feedback to researchers about their science. And so community members already come with natural advocacy skills. They advocate on behalf of whatever community they represent. We also train them in research fundamentals so that they can share their insights and firsthand knowledge based on their lived experiences with our research faculty. So they advise on study design, recruitment, informed consent language. You can come with just an idea. So while many of our faculty within MD Anderson and then UT School of Public Health utilize our community scientist pool, our postdoctoral fellows, and now even some of our doctoral students are able to present their research in front of this community panel. The great thing about it is you may not be able to have time to develop your own advisory board, you know, spend 2 years developing trust and relationships that I did. Now you can do it in a more quick fashion by, you know, sharing some of your ideas with our community scientist group. Also, there are clinical trial patient navigators. You may be familiar with clinical trial navigators more from a patient perspective, how to reduce people, making sure people come back for appointments if they have abnormal PAPs, to make sure that they come back to the clinic to get seen. Well, now clinical trials navigators is an evidence-based approach in order to increase the accrual of women and minorities to clinical trials as well. They help people understand what clinical trials are and create increase their interest in clinical trials and basically help to reduce barriers to help them join and stay within clinical trials. This is data from UAB, where MD Anderson was part of a consortium of cancer centers who were testing out these clinical trial navigators to see if they increased enrollment in trials, and found that patients will accept the navigation when offered. It resulted in increases in clinical trial participation, and they were four times more likely to complete the trial compared to people who did not have access to the clinical trial navigator as well. So this is a new program that we had been doing as part of the study in MD Anderson for many years. It went away, and now in our renewal period, we're going to be deploying clinical trial navigators to specific disease sites that have lower accrual to particular trials and need that particular help. And of course, can't forget, this is an opportunity for a student research opportunity. So over 75 student trainees, the majority of which are racial ethnic minorities, have participated within this Project Church infrastructure. They come from various disciplines and education levels, high school through postdoc fellows, but and also from historically Black college universities and minority-serving institutions. Students gain experience in community-based participatory research, cancer prevention, health disparities. Students publish papers, and those churches that enrolled in Project Church, we also have a summer program where those students come to MD Anderson for the summer and gain research experiences. So two particular training grants that I have that I have, again, utilized this infrastructure and that we draw from is a Susan G. Komen training grant to reduce cancer disparities. Received that grant in 2017, and we have four doctoral students who are participating in that. And then we have a P20 grant from NCI that is a collaboration between MD Anderson and the University of Houston, which is a Hispanic serving institution, in order to develop cancer research partnerships. So we also got that grant in 2017. We provide mentor research experiences to students, and then our students also do community outreach and education as part of their training. And the last thing I'll mention is the notion of a community mentor. So whereas we are very familiar with research mentors, and research mentors help guide us through the research process and how to develop into a researcher and generate a knowledge base, community mentors are people who can serve in that same way. And I would argue that alongside a research mentor, that many of our students should have community mentors whose job it is to provide access to community mentors, talk to real effective people, engage in community meetings and networks, and so engage in learning from a different perspective. Yes, we learn hands-on in a lab perspective, but the community is also a lab for that perspective, where they need to gain hands-on experience as well. They provide a bigger picture and impact for why the research we're doing is important, and these are our Komen scholars, and this is our Komen mentor who is helping to facilitate those relationships. So, future research in health disparities and community engagement. You know, we need to develop and evaluate translational teams that includes community perspectives, engaging sort of the community scientist program, clinical trials navigator. I believe the notion that altruism is a very strong motivating factor in the communities in which we want to serve. It's just the way that we approach them and engage them in that, but that can be useful in terms of engaging in the research project process. Consider the impact of age and sex and sexual and gender identity focused on cancer risk and cancer outcomes. So including only the necessary and relevant eligibility criteria, including Spanish-speaking populations as a minimum. I'm on a quest that at MD Anderson, we cannot keep saying that we cannot enroll Spanish speakers because we don't, you know, no one on my team speaks Spanish. No, we have a whole infrastructure that can translate informed consent documents. My center that I have can provide that kind of translation, but this becomes a common framework that is being used as an excuse, I think, for not being able to engage in those populations. So we're going to get rid of that over time. And using common measures beyond race, ethnicity, to collect those data because it allows for pooling and sharing of data. So if we're all collecting race, ethnicity in the same way, socioeconomic status in the same way, issues around acculturation, disability status, and so forth, that you might have a single trial that's focused on one population, but we may be able to pool our data in order to have more power to look at some of the disparities that we're interested in one single study that you may not be able to do that. So the implications for cancer disparities research is not a novel method. Community engagement is not, and now NCI recognizes as well, but it does work to bring the communities as alongside of us as we're trying to better their cancer health profile. There's a focus on community engagement principles, research methodology, intervention development, and student training, and it's replicable. I have a BCORI grant that just ended where we were using a similar module process for Asian Americans, not in a church-based setting, but still using some of that that those principles, and I mentioned Hispanics around Catholic churches. All right, so last slide is that community engagement is powerful and it can increase participation in and relevance of our cancer research. Hopefully my talk did convince you of that. And then I'd like to thank all of the Project Church churches that participated. Thank you.
That was great. Thank you. What a great infrastructure you created for so many more studies going forward too. Really wonderful. Roy?
Yeah, that's an amazing amount of work. Congratulations on that. You showed the slide about clinical trials and the low clinical trials accrual for everyone, mm-hmm. and then certainly for minorities. And while this is a grassroots type thing, and you're probably working with many people who don't have cancer,
right.
I would guess, you know, one of the metrics would be prevention trials, which I know you do a great mm-hmm. deal of having been there. But when do you expect that you'll see some impact? You know, when the CCSG grant is presented at MD Anderson, are you able to show at any point now that your number of minority patients and on trials is increasing?
Yes. So there are two factors that relate to participating in clinical trials. First, they have to be a patient. They have to come in the door. Then when they get in the door, are they on trials at a comparable rate? What we struggle with more at MD Anderson is getting, you know, sort of more diverse patients in the door. But when patients do come to MD Anderson, we have almost, in terms of the proportion of the population, representation on therapeutic trials, non-interventional trials, we have very good participation rates. We have a it's access. It's getting folks into the cancer center. And once we do, through the culture of the place, plus some of these other kinds of programs that I've mentioned that we have in place, can see, you know, proportionate representation.
As a follow-up, one thing we're doing is trying to get the trials out to the other centers. Are you doing that either with other Indiana Anderson centers, maybe some of the many other hospitals in Texas?
Yes. So within the city of Houston, we have sort of, we call them Houston area location sites. And there is a clinical trial infrastructure for those particular sites in the community to enroll those and enroll folks there in trials. Those locations do not tend to be in very diverse areas. So it increases clinical trial participation, but actually makes us look worse from minority participation on clinical trials because those that are participating primarily are white because that's where the those locations are located. You probably know that MD Anderson is, you know, on a world quest for world domination. So you'll see us in New Jersey and in Florida. And I don't know, we might show up down the street any day now. I'm just joking. I hope not. Oh, we are. I see. Look, just, you know, those sites are not included in our cancer trial data.
It's really wonderful work. And I have a similar question, but from a different perspective, and I'm wondering whether you're able to measure within your Project Church participation group delta changes in attitude about therapeutic clinical trials before and after participating, and or whether there's actually enough malignant disease developing within this cohort, which is a couple thousand people, and whether there's been any measurable output in terms of whether people go on trials because now they have less skepticism.
So I, you know, as you know, developing and maintaining real cohort studies is very expensive. So I think the initial thought was to to engage the community in research through this cohort design and follow them over time. But once the relationships were developed, to be able to do other things. So maintaining the cohort and continuing to follow people is not something that we've done to be able to show the data that you were, you know, talking about. Hindsight being 2020, of course, wish we had done that because I get that question a lot. And, you know, can't demonstrate it, you know, from that perspective.
Hi, yeah, thanks for that really interesting and rich talk. I had two sort of separate questions. One is, you know, we know that regular church attendance is associated with quite a significant lower mortality rate, all-cause mortality rate, and I think also depression rate. And I was wondering if in any of your studies you've been able to look at that within the different churches in terms of the breadth and depth of participation and whether that does have an impact on health and whether people in the churches were interested in that point. And then the other question was whether there was talk of bringing the clinic to the church, like in a big church with 5,000 people, there could be like health clinics right in the church with screenings and so forth that would maybe avoid a lot of the barriers of people getting there and getting in and et cetera.
So I'll tackle the latter one first. You know, screening is always as a really big issue because it's hard to sort of universally screen and then people find a cancer and then there's no follow-up care that you can, you know, sort of link them to. So I think that is, you know, great that you're in the state of Connecticut that theoretically, people have access to care due to Medicaid expansion so that you can be in the community in more of that strong way in order to be able to link them to care when something is diagnosed. So that we do have a mammography van and have some separate grants to try to increase colorectal cancer screening, but it's within a low-income clinic context. So we are like working with FQHCs in order to identify their own patient populations that aren't current and then provide the screening there and then navigate them back to the clinic and don't do as much of that from a community-based perspective because we need a place for them to follow up care. As it relates to sort of the improved health outcomes necessarily for mortality, other ways within a church context and lower sort of, let's say, perceived stress and depressive symptoms. I mean, there was a fair number. I don't know how it relates to the national average in terms of report of depressive symptoms, but high enough there that to your point, that you may think might have a different profile. So people were willing to still endorse depressive symptoms. You know, I mean, in this particular church, 30% who completed the survey, that's very, very high. So there are some benefits to, you know, sort of being in a church setting or being spiritual or having faith, but it's unclear from these data sort of where the benefits, you know, begin and end. There's still a lot of cancer risk and psychosocial health that needs to be addressed in that community, regardless of the fact that they attend church.
Well, thank you so much.